Good morning. Good morning, and welcome to the Institute Divine Metaphysical Research Incorporated. This is a school and not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, in the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan, operating throughout eternity until this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. Since that time, we established branch schools in the United States, Canada, and certain other foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we teach by the true, correct, and original names and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has improperly been substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has improperly been substituted by God. The true name of the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has erroneously been substituted by Jesus Christ. Now, Lord and God are titles and are not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are Lord's many and God's many. But we now know that each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is a title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but Jesus is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part in any good dictionary or encyclopedia will prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any letters or characters in their alphabet that produce a sound made by the letter J. Neither was there a J in the English language until some 1,400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings to the true, correct, original names and title. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Now, Yahweh is pure spirit, and in his pure spirit stays incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh on this chart symbolized as a cloud. But Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have drawn a cloud around the edge of this chart to show you how that everything on this chart abides within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man cannot perceive of him in his pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a superincorporeal being, that is, having a shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifests into a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there's only one name given among salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we must all ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in the school, we teach by divine pattern of the universe. It's called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him this tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. The pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up this one tabernacle pattern. Also in this school, we show proof how that everything is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing can escape the pattern. Our 10 primary constitutional objectives in the Institute are as follows. 1, to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. 2, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua Messiah without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. 3, to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or the so-called laws of nature and the powers latent in man. 4, to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures compared to religions, psychology, philosophy, modern practical and occult sciences. 5, to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. 6, to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through dispensation and ages. 7, to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through dispensation and time. 8, to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. 9, to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And 10, to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. Excuse me. This morning we'll have a prayer by Dr. Fernando Valdez, right? And a scripture reading of 1 Peter, the first chapter, by Dr. Bud Wunsch.
Dear Heavenly Father, we ask in the name of your Son, Yahshua, that you open up our heart and our mind to receive these great things and these jewels of wisdom and receive this revelation that you bestow unto us. We ask that you continue to bless us and sustain us in our lives so that we can continue to glorify you. We ask that you take care of our friends and family and, keep us in the knowledge and learning of this great gospel. These and many blessings, let's say, hallelujah, Yahshua.
You can hear it in the wind as it blows through the trees. You can see it in the wings of a bird flying free. You can see it in a flower as it reaches for the sky. Every ocean praises Yahweh in overwhelming signs. So let's sing hallelujah, let's sing hallelujah, let's sing hallelujah, let's sing, let's sing hallelujah, let's sing hallelujah, let's sing hallelujah, let's sing. His creation is a masterpiece no artist could touch. Oh no, no. Every color that he painted it with love. And his signature is seen on everything he made. Even you, for every breath you breathe his living name. So let's sing hallelujah, let's sing hallelujah, let's sing hallelujah, let's sing. Come on everyone, let's sing. Let every living thing, let every living thing praise his name. Come on, sing. So let's sing hallelujah, let's sing hallelujah, let's sing hallelujah, let's sing, 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 let's sing.
Good morning, class. This morning we will be reading the first chapter of 1 Peter. It will come from the Holy Name Bible, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Traina. He happened to have been an Italian Jew. He was with the Scripture Research Association Incorporated. This particular Bible was reprinted by Yahshua Promotions. 1 Peter, the first chapter, page 308. Peter, an apostle of Yahshua the Messiah, to the sojourners of the dispersion scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, elect according to the foreknowledge of Yahweh the Father through sanctification of the Spirit unto obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Yahshua the Messiah. Grace unto you and peace be multiplied. Blessed be the El and Father of our Savior Yahshua the Messiah, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a living hope by the resurrection of Yahshua the Messiah from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of Yahweh through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time, wherein ye greatly rejoice, though now for a season, if need be, ye are in heaviness through manifold trials. The trial of your faith being much more precious than of gold that perisheth, thought, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Yahshua the Messiah, whom, having not seen, ye love, in whom, though now ye see him not, yet believing, ye rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory, receiving the reward of your faith, even the salvation of your souls, of which salvation the prophets have inquired and searched diligently, who prophesied of the grace that should come unto you, searching what or what manner of time the Spirit of the Messiah, which was in them, did signify, when it testified beforehand the sufferings of the Messiah and the glory that should follow, unto whom it was revealed that not unto themselves, but unto us, they did minister the things which are now reported unto you by them that have preached the glad tidings unto you with the Holy Spirit, sent down from heaven, which things the angels desire to look into. Wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and hope to the end for that gift that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Yahshua the Messiah. As obedient children, do not conform yourselves according to the former lusts in your ignorance, but as he hath called you is holy, so be ye holy in all your conduct. Because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy. And if you call on the Father, who without respect to persons judgeth according to every man's work, pass the time of your sojourning here in fear. For as much as ye know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things, as silver and gold, from your foolish behavior transmitted from your fathers, but with the precious blood of the Messiah, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot, who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you, who by him do believe Yahweh, who raised him up from the dead, and gave him glory that your faith and hope might be in Yahweh, seeing you have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit unto the unfeigned love of the brethren, See that ye love one another with a pure heart fervently, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of Yahweh, which liveth and abideth forever. For all flesh is as grass, and all the glory of a man is the flower of grass. The grass withereth, and the flower thereof falleth away. But the word of Yahweh endured forever. And this is the word which by the glad tidings is preached unto you. That was 1 Peter, the first chapter. Let's all say.
Good morning, in class. Thank you very much, Bud and Fernando. We will have our first speaker will be Don Thomas. Oh yeah, it's coming. You got this. Bring the noise down.
Good morning, class. I was truly not expecting this. So, where to go? Well, I can start by saying this. I have stopped doing stuff my way and living up in my egotistical, misdirected personalities. I do stay prayed up. I don't do anything without running it past Yahweh first. You know, when I first wake up in the morning, I thank Yahweh. On my way out the door to go to work, let's go, Yahweh. You know, when I get out of my car and I'm walking in to clock in, let's start our day, Yahweh. When I get in my truck and I got to make my deliveries, okay, you drive. I'll just mentally operate this Yahweh. And because I do things that way, my life is a lot smoother today. Instead of thinking I got this or, you know, I done figured something out. It's not that I done did something so great. It's the fact that I include Yahweh in all my affairs. Even my little secret ideas and thoughts, I still run it by him. And then sometimes I say, I ain't even going to bring that to Yahweh. But, you know, even if I didn't, he still know what I'm thinking. So I'm already going to think. So I'm just going to, you know, put him in there. You know what I mean? And because of this class and because I'm not in church, I have the true gospel. You know, and when I call out to Yahweh, his true and correct name, instead of saying God, he hears me. You know, he don't turn his back. I don't call somebody God and expecting an answer. Just like if you call me up on the phone and say, can I talk to Debbie? You got the wrong number. You know what I mean? My name is Don. So since I know who he is and he knows my voice and he honors that, you know, and today my life is like really going smooth because, I mean, I come from a place that was all bad. And I'm telling you, I was all down here. If we wasn't going to go buy no drugs, if we wasn't drinking, if we wasn't chopping somebody up, if we wasn't running around robbing people, or if I'm not going up to you, hey, who went to jail, blah, 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 blah. You know, that's how it was for me, you know. And since I got into this class and all my old behavior, my character flaws, you know, I had to hang it up on that cross over there. And when I laid it down and presented it to Yahweh, here's my life. Here's all my here's all of my mess. You know, what can you do with it? You know? And he did a lot with it. You know, because just like on my job, you know, I started in at my job. I came in as a part-time handler, you know, and I worked Monday through Friday. And I was like, cool, you know. And then even with that job, you know what I mean? I wasn't even expecting to get the job that I had because around the corner on Airport Drive, they made the ramp, FedEx ramp. But I used to drive that way, you know, going to the connection, watching them build that building. And I'd be like, yeah, I'm going to get it right. I'm going to get it right. I got to stop all this, you know, and I'm going to go work right there. I thought that building was going to be Amazon. So every time I pass that building going to the connection, I say, Yahweh, I want to work right there. And so one day to the connection, the sign went up. Said FedEx. I said, huh? So then I said, okay, maybe it's a sign and I don't know which kind it was. So then I went to my auntie's house and used her little laptop and I put in for FedEx. And when I did, I thought it was this one right here around the corner. But when they called me, it was the one around that corner from that one on Francis Street off of Haven behind UPS. So I'm telling you, I put that application in at FedEx about between 9:30 and 10:30 in the morning. They called me by 12:30, 1:30. I was there the next day at 11:30, and I've been there ever since. But like I said, when I started there, you know, I wasn't expecting to go there. I got there as a part-time handler. I had a little bit of hours, and I was saying to Yahweh, thank you for this, you know, because if I ever get straight, I need to be connected to a giant that's bigger than me so I can have somewhere to stay until I decide to retire. And he did that. So then I got there and I was the handler. And like 2 weeks after I was working there, I always go in on Saturday, volunteer, help them. So and that's where I got more money at, because that little money, it was okay, but I was trying to do other things. Then, you know, I took my little forklift license class. The man came from New York, FedEx, and came and trained some of us. And I slid into that, you know, because I didn't have the seniority to get in there. But then I told them, you know, I'm in here. You know, I come even when I ain't supposed to be here. I need to be up in there. Yahweh honored that. Got my forklift license. Then I moved up. I got another little promotion. I moved over to the dock sort. And that's where we have all the, you know, manila envelopes and small packages. So I was doing that. So then I put in for another job at my job. I was a part-time driver. I started there in Corona Norco. And man, I'm telling you, when I became a driver, I was like, what did I sign up for? I was really ready to quit, you know, but I couldn't go home and tell mom how I was feeling, you know, because then, you know, when I tell her I'm feeling some kind of way, she gets scared thinking I'm about to go to the connection. So I just kept that to me, and I was like, I shouldn't have never did that. And, you know, eventually Yahweh touched my supreme crown, and I was able to figure it out, and then I figured it out. And, you know, everything just been smooth sailing. And then I got on another shift. Okay, I was already AM, so I'm like AM second shift. My plane comes in at 10:30 with all our freight. So I leave the building about 12:30, 1:15. So I went and I start doing that. And so I had a new route. My route now is 929, which I cover Laverne, Pomona, and Claremont. And while I was doing that, I said, what's next, Yahweh? I said, I think I want to be a manager. I want to be a manager. I think I got what it takes. And I certainly can deal with all personalities in any kind of situation, you know. Because, I mean, And I figured to myself, they already know their job, so it's all the other drama and little blah, 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 blah I'm gonna have to deal with. So I was talking to my manager, and I was telling him, I need to be lead supervisor because blah, 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 you know. And so then he was like, And that's what he said, And so then I left. I was like, I ain't going to show any emotions or whatever, because when I was talking to my senior manager was like, Don, I really do like you. You can do this. And she said, leave your emotions on the other side of the swing gate. And when she told me that, I was like, right. It made sense of me watching and knowing how I am and how I operate. You know, I can't show any emotion like that, because I used to be extremely over the top in hyphy. And if something was wrong with me, you knew about it. But today, you don't know. You know, and I just walk around FedEx, and I'm just evaluating. And they look at me and everybody, what's the matter, Don? Don, what's the matter? Nothing. You know what I mean? But they're not accustomed to me not bullshipping around with them and clowning on that belt. So as I just walk around and I'm looking and seeing what needs to be done, they think something is wrong, but I have to change a lot of things around. So I gets back to management. So he puts me in the AIM 2 program, and that's aimed towards management, the up and coming one. So he got me up in that. He got me my email address through FedEx and my password so I can get into that. And that's what I be working on. Then he was like, well, I need for you to get up in the safety crew. So I'm in the safety crew as well. And then my senior manager, Tish, was like, you need to be on the safety crew, blah, blah, it's going to look good on resume, you need to know this, and I need you to walk around the station and see what those safety hazards is, there's oil down there, you need to make sure the trucks are road ready, you need to have this paperwork. That I was like, I got it. Okay, so day before yesterday, I went to my boss about the lead and supervisor, and he was like, you got it. I was like, oh, I just wanted to, you know, do my little happy gig and stuff, but thank you very much. He was like, okay, well, come walk with me. So now we, you know, walking around trying to figure stuff out. And that made me feel really good. And see, none of this is possible had I not been in class, had I not been prayed up, and had I been in church. Because if I was in church, I'm going to still be at the spot. Because that's how it's been all my life, and another day is not going to change how it was. You know? I come to know Yahweh for who he is and how he actually exists, and I hear him talking to me. You know? And then, like, some people will say, well, they say God never talks to me. Yes, he do. You just unaware of it. You know? Just how that man said, I am Yahweh, you know, you just don't know? Okay, that's me too. Because this little tabernacle right here, this still Yahweh, and the personality of Don Thomas walking around FedEx, feeling happy and proud, because he gave me my life back, but he gave me a way better life. You know, things that I do today, I wasn't expecting to be doing, you know, because I remember once upon a time, my mom would come visit me in the penitentiary at CIW, Chowchilla, VSP, Sybil Brand, Biscaloo, all that. That was me. But today I got a package that Don Thomas is driving in to CRC, you know. Well, I go through they double gates, and I come right back out. And I remember I had to go in my truck, and I'm going to the prison mailroom. So I had to pass their yard. And I see the inmates out there walking the track around, just poking around just like this. And I said, oh, because that was me. I just stopped my truck, and I was just looking. Like, if I can just talk to him and let him know. Just because it looked like and it feels like, and you think you defeated, you don't know what the future holds. You know what I mean? And I drove around, and I was just looking at them, because I'm telling you guys, that was me on the yard, broken, and always, I mean, sorry, regretful. You know, I'm telling you, my tail, you know. I remember even, you know, it feels good to have your life right, because I haven't forgot anything. I remember walking, my house is around the corner right here. And I'll come down that side street right there to get the hole and walk all the way to Pomona. So I can go get me $20, $30, $40 worth of crack. Because my mama mad, I want to smoke, and she won't give me no damn ride, but I'm gone. And I remember walking in the heat, in the cold, in the rain, and cars just zoom by me. Okay? And I just gotta get there. And as I'm walking and I'm thinking, trying to get there, the pain that I had, you know, me told me, you will never have your own car again. You know, you'll never get no good job. You're only good enough to do hair. And I am, and that's who I am and what I do. If they will show up when they make their appointments and without that no show, no call. Because when you call me, I'm speculating in my head. That's my paycheck. And then I don't hear from you. So I just had all this going on. You know what I mean? You know how that felt? And then there'd be sometimes I'd be out there smoking, and it's hot. I got a handful of crack, and I'm thirsty as hell, and ain't got $1, and I need a drink. I ain't forgot. And them same streets I was walking down to get to the connection. I see other addicts. They touch me. You know? And yes, yeah, so I do sometimes, most of the time, I pull over for them, give them some money, bam, gotta go. Because I have to pay with forward, you know, to keep mine going. Because Yahweh kept me. If I can help keep somebody else until they can get to know Yahweh how I do, then that's what I'm going to do. You know what I mean? I'm going to do that. And it doesn't matter what you need the money for, whatever help or whatever. I have to help you. I wouldn't feel right being me if I don't help you. You know, there's times that I zoom past stuff and I thought about it all the way I got home. As soon as I pull in my parking spot, I'm getting out, I'm backing up to go back to help. So I have to. So once you leave all the carnality out of it and your ego and your pride, all that gotta go. You know, there's just like some, the guy Gary on the belt 4 days ago, he said something to me. Don, do you want me to help you with your Claremont? I mean, because if Brandon says it's okay, I'll help you with your Claremont. Because sometimes my route is heavy. But I said to me, forget about asking somebody if you can help me. If you want to help me, you'll say, Don, give me 10 of them Claremonts. Is what I thought. So when he said that, I said, nah, that's all right. I got it. Because you done already made me mad with that, because if you want the help, you should have came and got it, according to my logic. I'm on my route, you know. I'm just finishing up Pomona. Just left Casa Colina. Yahweh said, you know you wasn't right. So I gets back to my next stop up the street. So I called Gary up to say, my bad, Gary. I just, you know, misdirected anger, whatever. However I was going to put it, I was out of pocket. So I was going to make it right with Gary. Gary didn't pick up the phone because Gary must have been at somebody's porch by then, okay? So I text him and told him. So we cool. Oh, no, you're not tripping down, da-da-da-da-da-da. But I had to do that to feel right because I'm out here on the road and that thinking about that little stuff, Yahweh convicts in a big way today. So I had to do that and make it right, and we're cool to this day. So I'm just here to let you guys here in class know and out there at home looking at class, stop doing it your way because you're not going to win. You're wasting your time. You know what I mean? You have to run it by Yahweh. I didn't say God. I didn't say Yahweh. Okay? You got to run your artillery, your syllabus, whatever you want to call it you got going on, through Yahweh. And it fits up in the purpose and the plan. He don't see you through it because he did me. Thank you for listening.
Our next speaker will be Dr. Aaron Alanis.
Morning, class. Morning. Yes, for real, Don.
Yes.
What you did was you took yourself out the way. So it made sense. To you, it seemed like you're just going over your simple day, right? To me, I heard you going in through the gate, coming up in here, working this pattern, getting some illumination to your darkness. It was beautiful, man. To see the growth that Yahweh is putting in you, oh, it's so beautiful, Don. Oh, man. From you not even to be able to sit still for a second and focus in to now you're up here going over egotistical, misdirected personalities. Oh, man. That's big, huge. So don't question it. It's happening. And you only inspire every time you get up here. I remember there was a time I used to be like, oh, man, what's Don going to say today? But now it's like, where's Don at, man? She hasn't gone up here for a second. I want to hear what she's got to say. Because you just keep it real. Right. You just keep it straight, and you keep it 100. That's all I could say. You're not trying to be anybody. You're not trying to nothing. You're just keeping it, and you're Yahweh is working with you. Right. And it is beautiful. I've been there. I had an addiction problem for a little bit. I was addicted to meth. Yes, I was. There was a time I had a house, but I was still sleeping outside. Yeah. And I had a job. I was actually the foreman for a steel distribution company while I was doing this, working 16-hour days. Yeah. Mm-hmm. In charge of a whole team. Yeah. Oh, I had money. And the worst part about it, I wasn't even paying for what I was getting. And I was just like you. At the end of the day, I had all those physical things I wanted. But when I was thirsty and I needed a drink, I didn't have no money. I didn't have a cent. It was a reflection of my mental state at the time as well. Of my spiritual state. I was searching and looking as well for a father figure. My dad was in and out of prison my whole life. And it left this seeking, this void that I didn't think anybody else felt. Which I would look for that father figure in almost every single male figure in my life, actually. Friends, family, acquaintances. I remember explaining it to one of my friends like this. I take pieces from each person I run into and I form this figure. Now, for the longest time, that made no sense to me, but I said it. I mean, it made sense to how I was looking at it. Not until recently when I started learning and looking at the plate 26 and the image that Nebuchadnezzar saw, did it start making any sense. So, Don, these experiences that we go through physically, these things that happen to us, they're not always going to make sense right away. Your daily activities might not seem like it right now, but they're going according to a purpose, a pattern, and a plan. And people who understand that purpose, pattern, and plan can even see what's coming. Yeah, it was really funny. I was told that by the age of 30, I'd be in here. I'd be in here asking questions. Around the age of 30, when I started coming in here. Then I started coming often, learning about this purpose, pattern, and plan. And something started standing out to me in the back of my mind, slowly. Something about 33. And not until about December of last year did it really start picking up. And Yahweh told me, when you turn 33, that total image will be shattered. You're going to die. That image is dead. Today is January 23rd, 2022, and I have turned 33. I see this thing so differently. And it's not just the magical number, you know, of 33, but how old was Joshua when he took off this flesh on that cross there? 33 and a half, about, right?
Yeah.
So these things are going according to a purpose and a pattern and a plan. That's been what's been on my mind recently. And your testimony of going over what you used to go about and when you were down here in Egypt only inspires me to keep going as well. Because I can look back at what Aaron wanted to do. I could look back at how Aaron would have chose to do this or that or this or that. But now that I have been shown light and I have the way, the truth, and the life resurrected in Yahshua, and that's where my mental state is right now. And that's where it will remain. I might not be physically there, but spiritually, that's where I'm at. That's where you're at. That's where you can keep going. That the Holy Spirit, who may keep you from falling. But like you stated, Don, you have to get rid of, well, you don't get rid of anything. Yahweh has to get rid of that carnality for you. And I'm just so thankful for the chances that I was given this whole time to see glimpses and glimpses to keep me going until this point. And the knowledge and the wisdom that I've come into by simply seeking Yahshua. Taking a little bit of time out of my busy day to read a little bit, a couple pages, a couple words, so that I can be in one place focusing and then Yahshua could minister to me. Now, Yahweh is spirit. Correct? And when you worship Yahweh, you must worship him in spirit and in truth. So not once did I say that I was going by these Ten Commandments. I was in a bad place. I was breaking most of these things. Because that wasn't meant for us.
Right.
That was meant for them.
Yeah.
Back here in the wilderness. And it's even shown proof of that when Moses breaks that first set of stones with those Ten Commandments written on them. As an example or type and shadow of this, no longer physical sacrifices, ordinances, carnal ordinances, no more. And then had to hew out another set of stones, bring them back up, type of shadow of, that would come back down with those new set of stones, and a type and shadow of a new covenant. And those set of stones were put into this most holy place, or the Ark of the Covenant. This pattern lines up with our physical body. Okay? This pattern consists of, which, like we go over in the moderation, a court roundabout or outer court, which it might be over here, a holy place, and a most holy place. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. Just like you have a head region, chest region, and abdominal region. These make up the one human body, the core of it. Now you have appendages, and we can actually cut these off and live without them. There's examples in everyday life. But the point that I'm trying to get to is that law, or these, that new covenant was placed in here, I stated. I also stated that this is their body is likened to this tabernacle pattern. So in this most holy place, or your head region, is where that new covenant is, or that law. It is written how does it go? It's written without hands. Right? Is that the quote, not right? Yeah. And he was going to write it in our inward parts. Right. Or the spirit. Yeah. Now, Don, you brought up a good example of that. That you can't just walk away from it. It keeps nudging at you and poking at you. You should do this. You should really do this. Yeah. You should, you know, putting on almost like a guilt trip, right? Because yeah. 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 It's in you. It's now in you. That's just a small example of it. Oh, yeah. Well, Yahweh's the only reason you move. Yeah. Right? What do we learn? Breathe in. Yeah. Without that, you're not moving. Yeah. Yeah. Breathe life into you, just like he breathed life into Adam. That was the spirit coming into the world. Well, in physical form. And then moving down through the ages and dispensations. Now, I'm able to tell you all these things all because of Yahshua. And Yahshua working through a man by the name of Henry C. Kinley. But once that Yahshua took over and changed that mind, right. It was no longer H.C. Kinley. It was Yahshua bringing all this to light. Because before all this, and even to this day, there's not really anybody teaching about any of this. The way that is being taught here. Now, there's classes that are sprouting up, but even those classes, they were once members or students here. Now, all Yahshua through Dr. Kinley was doing was confirming the same vision that Moses saw, and the same vision that John on the Isle of Patmos saw. Not changing anything, not doing it, just confirming what's already been there this whole entire time, which was set up in eternity. Right. Now, the way he even knows about any of this is through a vision. And that's how all of this is coming about. Because before Moses got the vision at the burning bush, we didn't even know Yahweh's name. All the forefathers he dealt before Moses all knew him as El Shaddai. And none of them wrote anything or kept a record in that way. Again, Moses was given a vision. Now, this vision that I'm about to talk about here is after he received the name in this vision. And after Yahweh freed the children of Israel out of captivity from Egypt. And it comes back to when I was talking about when he broke the tables of stone. It was actually the third trip when he hewed out the second set and went up that he saw in this vision the genealogies and pedigrees after the initial creation. And this is how we even get Genesis. In the beginning, most people know it as God created the heavens and the earth. Now, usually people misconstrue that as just in the beginning of creation. And that brings up the question then, how are you able to see this? Is Adam writing that? Is that from Adam's account? Like he was seeing that the whole time? Things don't really make sense when seen like that. But when you understand that Moses is having a vision about these, then you know that in the beginning of the vision, Yahweh created the heavens and the earth. And that's how we get Sorry, just got thrown off for a second. The vision. It's talking about the vision. Now, before going any further, another important thing that you have to understand about this vision is what this is where we also get the tabernacle pattern. And this tabernacle pattern is Elohim. And Elohim is the archetype original pattern of the universe. Now, in this vision that Moses was seeing, he saw the superincorporeal being known as Elohim, the title of Elohim. This supercorporeal being transmuted into this threefold tabernacle pattern, showing that he is the pattern. And then after this pattern transmuted back into the superincorporeal being of Elohim, and then from Elohim came the creation of the days, or the creation in this vision, because the creation didn't take seven solar days to make. Yahweh just willed it and it was. But each day that Moses saw in this vision, at the end of it, Elohim would go back into the superincorporeal state, then come out again, back out until the seventh day. And then came back. And on the first trip, no, yes. Second trip, that's what. Second trip, he sees after the 7 days, the remaining 33 days, he sees the inner workings of this tabernacle pattern and the furnishings. Now, this pattern, like I stated before, consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court roundabout. Each one of these compartments have furnishings. In the court roundabout, you have the brazen altar of sin sacrifice, where they would lay a sacrifice when they broke one of the Ten Commandments. A sacrifice had to be made for them. What is it? Innocent sacrifice? Yeah, innocent sacrifice in their place, pretty much. It was taking the place of them. It was dying for them, pretty much, innocent, without blemish. Then there was the brazen laver of water. This is where they would cleanse the sacrifice, or the high priest would cleanse the sacrifice and then cleanse himself. You also had the holy cup of anointing oil, which would be poured on the high priest and the two low priests before entering the holy place. Now this cup of oil is likened to a quickening, and again is put right before the door, right before entering into the holy place, which the holy place has three furnishings of the table of shewbread with the 12 loaves likened to the 12 tribes of Israel. And then you have the seven branch lampstand or candlestick, which we just went over a class ago, and how it represents the dispensations and a bunch of other things, but it was the light and represents the light that lit up this. And Yahshua is that light that lights up this whole holy place and you and your body. You also have this altar of incense, which gave a sweet savory smell unto Yahweh. So you, and was consisted of four main ingredients. Now, I don't know off the top of my head. I would have to study that a little bit more, but four main ingredients and specific specific ingredients mixed a specific way that only the high, only the two low priests and the high priests knew about. And if they were, if they did not mix in this certain way and use this certain the four ingredients, they would be stricken dead. You could see this actually an example in there of Nadab and Abihu, right? They were the ones first ones to make try to put their own mix and whatnot in there, and they were struck dead. Now you have this most holy place, but before you enter this most holy place, there's the second veil. Right here, you see a first veil right before you go into the holy place. So it could, when you talk about the steps, which I'll go over in a second, the fourth can be the door or the first veil. Now they have this second veil, which separates the holy place from the most holy place. This holy place has a 3-in-1 configuration right here, which is the two mercy seat, the two archangels overlooking the mercy seat. And now inside this ark, you had the Ten Commandments, or the second set of stones that Moses hewed out and then brought back down. A jar of manna and Aaron's rod that budded into almonds. Now, those are your nine primary furnishings. I always want to say vessels. Nine furnishings. Now, your steps for this pattern would be, the first is the gate. Then you second would be your brazen altar of sin sacrifice. Then your third would be the brazen laver of water. Your fourth, like I said, would be the door or the first veil. And at the door is when you would get the holy cup of anointing oil poured on you. Then you have the holy place, which is the whole fifth step. Now, you have the second compartmental veil, like we told you, was separating the most holy place and the holy place, and that is your sixth step. And the seventh step is this holy, most holy place, which once the high priest worked this whole tabernacle once a year, once he would get on and go through, you go around it three times, right? On a Day of Atonement. And once he did those three, on the third time, he would witness the flash of the Shekinah, which is likened to, was it gaining that knowledge, getting that intelligence, that spark. Now, everything is patterned, everything in the universe is patterned after this tabernacle pattern. From a cell to, like I said, the human body, the forms of liquid, anything you can think of is made by this pattern and operates by this pattern. And there's nothing you could think of that escapes this pattern. Like I said, this pattern is Elohim. Right? Now, if this pattern is Elohim, then we are all in Elohim, because from Elohim came the creation. And we came out of this creation because we're part of that creation. Now, there's no getting out of Elohim. There's no getting out of Yahweh. That's why we can say that this whole cloud that is being used to represent Yahweh, because it has no particular shape or form, is encircled here to show that the entire creation dwells within the realm of eternity, or Yahweh. In like manner, Yahshua is within you. So there, whether he's within you or without you, it's going to be Yahshua. It's going to be Yahweh. And Yahshua is the only name that will save you and your only hope of salvation. And if you've gotten anything out of what I just said, then all praise be to Yahweh through his only son, Yahshua Messiah. Thank you.
I'm going to still get you, Chris. Now bring the noise, Chris. Don't bring any noise. Tell us something. Bring whispers.
All right, our last and final speaker will be our dean, Dr. Marlon Love.
Said when you went up? He said, bring the noise, dog.
Good afternoon, class. A pleasure to be here and to once again have something to say about this great divine and stupendous vision and revelation that we received and have heard by way of Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, whom in the year of 1931 had a vision. And we hear something within us as we've listened to the previous speakers have a testimony about the things they've heard within them based off having been associated with this school and what they've learned or come to learn about themselves, about any number of things whereby they've seen a change within their disposition, if you would, and what they might have once did versus what they're doing now. And some of that's age, but then because there's a type and shadow, Romans 1:19 and 20, if you can grab that, bud, I'd appreciate that. Because that's what we do with our children, if you would. We want them to grow up and act like adults or responsible adults, just naturally so. And so when we have the grace of Yahshua having us in one location and have had the knowledge of knowing what Egypt represents and to be able to perceive that when we're going through or had went through some period of time that we couldn't see clearly, didn't know what we were doing, and frustrated, and represent that and see that Egypt represents that state of mind, that's a big weight, if you would, just to recognize what Egypt represented. Now, we might have been to church or some whatever religion one comes from, not really understanding what this Egypt is all about, because we've all heard the Bible. Bible told me so, and depending on, doesn't matter which denomination you come from, born in it or not, you still have to come to a revelation about Yahshua the Messiah, and that's going to be predicated on him, but through a teaching, because I had you get Romans 1:19 and 20, but then Romans, give me Romans. You're here at Romans, so give me 10th chapter of Romans. Right around 6, you say the feet of them that preach the glad tidings, I think it says. Maybe 7-ish.
And 15?
Yeah. See what it says.
Well, let's start at 10:13. For whosoever shall call upon the name of Yahweh shall be delivered.
Now, Don had made mention of calling by the name of Yahweh. Now, you got to know more than just Yahweh's name. Mm-hmm. We have to have an understanding about Yahweh. Our first aim is to help you find and know. That know is a knowing of an intimacy, if you would, of an understanding. It's not that I just know Don. I've never been to your place. I don't know your birthday. I don't know much information about you other than when you come here and hang out for 2 hours or whenever you come. Mm-hmm. That's not really knowing you. And knowing how to know any much of the history you've put down, I don't know any past about you. But when it's when I say intimate, it's not a physical intimacy, it's an understanding about Yahweh mm-hmm. that supersedes just saying the name. Right. Keep reading.
How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed?
How they're gonna call on Yahweh? When you're in stuck like a duck, some people never come out of this state of a Stygian black darkness and never come into an awareness of anything. And it's by a preaching or a teaching that you've heard, that we've heard, in order to hopefully germinate as a seed does when you have a dead seed, a dead state of thinking, a lack of any light. You have to bury a seed into an earth. That seed is dead. That's your blood principle, if you would, or your death principle. Seeds are dead. They remain dead until something germinates it, stimulates it, if you would. And they got to be in a death state. And it's that water. After you've planted it and buried it, which is symbolic of this water, and it being buried in that seed being buried in the water, or in the soil, then you have that spirit, which is typified of water, because you have to pour that water on that soil. And that water, it begins to germinate. And then that sun, those elements, it takes a period of time. You just won't put water on the seed, it just sprouts up and you got fruit and foliage on it, right? There's a period of time. That's why you have that 40 principle in this holy place. Line of this threefold tabernacle pattern that Aaron spoke about. Because after you have the dead seed, it's buried in the ground, and you pour that water, which is water symbolic of spirit, it begins to work. That sun has to come in, and then you have a period of time of that growth until it ascends, whereby you have the plumage or the fruit that you're bearing, which is what you want from that tree. That is what we're trying to come into an understanding or a consciousness. That's a how that's done. Just like the gospel of 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter, Saul talks about 1 through 4. You don't have to get it. That's the gospel. How he died. How he was buried. And how he resurrected according to the scriptures, right? Or the law and the prophets. And we have to understand how that's done. And this is what we're expressing here in Romans. Keep reading.
And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard?
Now, how are you going to believe in him and you haven't heard of? Don and Aaron talk about it. They're hearing something. She pulled into the driveway and she feels inclined to go do something. And that's Yahweh working with her. We're all different. Different with the manifestation changes, but the principle remains the same. Hey, there's some bad things that people have experienced down in Egypt. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't matter whether you had a silver spoon in your mouth, you're born and happy, you never saw the side of a prison or not. We're not looking at that. That's why it's not an egregious thing to hear things, because everybody's different. That's the manifestation. But if we're looking at the principle, and that's where the emotion comes, and that's where the inspiration, if you would, that something is germinating, something's clicking, something's working, and that's the proud thing. When the baby begins to walk, they got to crawl or scoot. That's a proud thing. And you know that at some point in time, you're going to be able to, as you say oftentimes, Don, you want to be able to teach. You want to be able to expound upon things, because you've heard someone tell you these things over the course of years, and you weren't in here just one class. You've been here a lot of years. in order to, but you know, or recognizing now as that egotistical misdirected personality is taking hold, but you haven't done it. It's been the structure and the function of the things you've begun to hear about, that we've begun to hear about. This chart takes our picture. So anything you say is not surprising. This is a different rendition. But if you begin to look at the principle of this migratory pattern, as we call it, the greater, more perfect tabernacle pattern, you have a court roundabout. You have the holy place. You have Canaan's land. Understanding that this is patterned after the tabernacle that Moses saw in a vision. Now, it goes to vision again. You have, one has to recognize and see that this is a real structure that Yahweh Elohim had Moses to make, and it came from a vision. Mm-hmm. It was invisible. Hard to believe that. That's what we just read in, you just read in Romans, talking about belief and hearing. Go ahead.
How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard?
They ain't heard him. They ain't not believe him. Because remember, the children of Israel, they all died, meaning they, the soul, the first from out of Egypt, all died save three, Caleb, Phinehas, and Eleazar, that were originally down here in Egypt, which also testifies to our inner man being of our conscience, of our thinking, about how we're thinking something's happening according to the pattern that we have that is going to have to go away. So it's not surprising. It becomes beautiful when you see that inner man and being able to sit and be attentive for a period of time, just as we do with kids. But we see a kind of a rehearse with kids who have ADHD, but they either want to drug them with something, they want to give them something. That's for us to see according to a principle what's that manifesting as, why that's manifesting. They may never see it, but for those of us that do see it, we're grateful and thankful that this tabernacle pattern is taking our picture and is going by this pattern by which, as we rehearse it, it's going to bring in a reconciliation, if you would, of who and what we really are. But keep reading. How is this done? Through what? Read.
And how shall they hear without a preacher?
Mm-hmm. Hear and see without a preacher. Something to be said to you. Because the book's been around a long time. They've been reading it for since Timbuktu, and they can't figure it out. He couldn't figure it out. He was in the Church of Christ for 15 years as an assistant pastor. He didn't know. And when he said he did receive a divine vision and revelation, when he came back down, when he read the book, it read no more ever the same. Totally changed. And he began to teach as a preacher to those who Yahweh had called in order to hear him preach. Keep reading.
And how shall they preach except they be sent?
Mm-hmm.
As it is written, mm-hmm. How beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace.
Now, we want to preach a gospel of peace, not peace out into the world. Peace within your soul, within your nature, being at rest with Yahweh, seeing the manifestations that, as Aaron says, there's an abundance of the parts of threes, morning, noon, and night, mm-hmm. Forks, knife, and spoon. Whatever you want to call it, the waves, land, air, and sea, right? All these things point up to Yahweh, mm-hmm. The name of Yahweh. We breathe the name of Yahweh. And so when we begin to see how this invisible Elohim can be seen, Romans 1:19 and 20.
Romans 1:19 and 20.
Mm-hmm.
Because that which may be known of Yahweh.
Now you can know something about that which you hear. and that you see in various manifestations. The manifestation is not Yahweh. Yahweh is, I will be what I will to be. And he's willed to be everything in his creation. But to understand how and why it works, whereby we can have some peace and rest within our soul, we have to be able to find that, find him and know him. How are we going to do that, though?
Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them.
Now, it was manifest in them, in the children of Israel. Because you got Saul expressing this and how they were called first in order to do what? Set up a process that would be manifested, whereby at some point in time that it will be used as a schoolmaster in order to bring us unto Yahshua Messiah. And that becomes our endeavor to do in this school, is to help you find and know Yahweh our Elohim and Yahshua the Messiah. I'll just say it like that. Because Yahshua the Messiah was the first begotten of Yahweh. Does that make sense, Don? I said Yahshua the Messiah was the begotten. Now, we understanding that Yahshua could come in through the loins of the Virgin Mary. But because we understand principles of how that Virgin Mary was likened to Virgin Mother Earth. And we understand how Virgin Mother Earth brought forth, we'll say, Adam from out of the ground of Virgin Mother Earth. But then you also have Yahweh, John 1:1, it talks about in the beginning was the Word. And that Word, as we have on the name chart, says Word or Son. But Elohim is a divine title. It's not a name. But therefore, we have through understanding by way of the vision, see how Moses saw the Elohim. And we have to understand how he got up here. Remember, when they, children of Israel, had to perform a certain event called the Passover in order to come up from out of Egypt to and through the Red Sea, a three-day journey, in order to gather around the base of the mount, which we understand the Jews and the Jews only, as Aaron said, were the only ones that were going to be receiving or that Yahweh was working with at the time in order to establish establish this event that he's having of this migration of the children of Israel. Whereby now, at a point in time, 7 days later, after this first trip into the mount, whereby Yahweh spoke down the Ten Commandment law, on this second trip, we understand, if we got Exodus 24:9-10, that Yahweh or Moses wrote, whereby that Moses and his minister, Yahshua, is going to be coming up into this mountain. Because they remember, they told Aaron, Abraham, and Bayou, and the 70 elders to remain here on this plateau. And then Aaron and Hur will be with them. While Moses and his minister, which we now know as Yahshua the Messiah. Because we're looking at the Spirit. We say in the moderation, as it was so beautifully stated today, that the Holy Spirit manifesting in or out of a physical body is Yahshua the Messiah. That Spirit, that is Yahweh, is salvation, or coming in his Father's name. This is all one in their unity. So when we see how Yahshua the Messiah, at the appointed time, appearing in Egypt at around 30 years old, right? And he is the one that leads them to and through the Red Sea. And he's called here with his Moses to come up into this mountain. It's Yahshua the Messiah that transformed or transfigured before the 73 years, and they saw that Elohim, or they saw Yahshua the Messiah, because this is Spirit. In the moderation, we say this vision can be has to be understood by divine. It has to be understood by a vision. By divine vision, revelation. Understood by a divine revelation, right? And it says, and this Spirit took on shape and form of a man, right? And it manifested on earth. Mm. So we have Yahshua, and we can see how that unity is never separated. It's not a Yahshua down here and a Yah or a Elohim here. We're not making that mistake. We understand that it's the Holy Spirit, and if we understand that this migration is taking our picture because he's using the first nation of people, the Israelite nation at that time, in order to bring forth or to establish his setup. Now, once he gets them to and through this Red Sea, and as Aaron said it, on his third trip, when Moses came up alone and by himself, he saw the recapitulation of this 7 days, or the creation, and then the next 33 days, he sees the fall of the fall of man by way of Adam, down all the way to the outpouring of the Holy Spirit until it was completed in full. And so when we understand how that third trip is going to be a round trip, if you would, because when he comes down, they tarry here in the wilderness for some 40 years, right? Because of unbelief. They couldn't see, and it wasn't meant for them to see, because Yahweh setting up and establishing these things in order to what? Come through this river Jordan, which is likened to this second compartmental veil, if you would, that Aaron talked about in this tabernacle, because these are the veils. This first veil would be indicative of the Red Sea, if you would. So you got roundabout being Egypt, the wilderness, and look, in the wilderness, they're working, they're going around and around in order to and they're following the cloud, but the high priest only and the two low priests, they were allowed to function or work or give service within this holy place or this fifth step, if you would. So there's activity, and understanding that this second compartmental veil, only the high priest ever went in here. I think I heard Chris say on the Day of Atonement, right, that they was able, that this high priest was going to function and walk around here until at a point in time, if all things were done in decency and in order by the high priest, then there would be a Shekinah or a revealing that Elohim is still with them and is not going to destroy them. And so when we see how this step works, we see that, hey, there was a promise given to Abraham, and by way of Abraham, that he was going to have this seed, singular, that's going to come in down to a land, come down into Egypt, right, and then be strangers in this land, and then at a point in time, going to return back into Canaan's land, right? And we understand, and that's a type, that's a setup for us to take a picture of, or to emulate, to see that's the setup. So by the time, at a point in time when Yahshua Messiah comes on, he begins to let people know about who and what he is. You still have Romans 1:19-20, yes. Eunice? Yeah. Keep reading.
For Yahweh hath showed it unto them.
Okay.
For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world, mm-hmm, are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made.
Now, this is what was instituted, and this was what was made and what was set up. Mm-hmm. It was given a promise to Abraham. Mm-hmm. Abraham, through his sons, Isaac and Jacob, who later became Isaac, and later became Israel. And then when Israel came down to here, into Egypt, and they remember, I just went through the story, right? That's what was set up for our learning by them. And when we see how them migrated and came to the Canaan's land, the promised land, so now we're going to be able to see how Yahshua is going to use what he did set up, mm-hmm, by this way, John 5:39. Now remember, this is Moses' account, and that Moses wrote Genesis, Exodus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Exodus and Leviticus, right? Those first five books constituting the law. And then we have the next 34 books from Joshua to Malachi being the prophets. So now they, meaning this nation of people, had this script. Read.
Ye search the scriptures.
Okay. That's the script. The scriptures are the scriptures that they had to search. All of these Jewish people were searching about Yahweh. Not using the name, because we know they changed the name. They didn't have no belief. They're not understanding anything that's going on. But now you have the Messiah having resurrected again. And now he's talking to them here. Read.
For in them ye think ye have eternal life.
Now, this is what we're after too. But you see, Yahshua was the sacrifice for all of mankind. And it's going to be by Yahshua that we're going to need to know how, as we read there in Romans. Right? And now they have this book called the Scriptures. And then what did he tell them about it?
And they are they which testify of me.
They are they, meaning the law and the prophets. You don't call a book or a scripture they. Do you? That's what it said, right? If it's the scriptures, why is it a they? It is the law and the prophets, which comprises of the scriptures. That's the they. And what are you going to get to do with the they? Read.
But and they are they which testify of me.
They, the scriptures, are testifying of who he is. And we have to be able to recognize who, how he is by what? Keep reading.
But ye will not come to me that mm-hmm. ye might have life.
Because they're looking at the flesh, the physical things of who he was. And he was a scrawny run, if you would, as far as he was not to be desired. Mm. Manifestation. That's why we don't ought not to run around looking at the manifestations of people, because we have scriptures talking about in the one portion of the book, when a lowly man comes, he sent him in the back, and someone that looks like they have a golden spoon in their mouth with regalia on, you sent him up front. You're discerning and making a difference between a physical manifestation and not a spiritual understanding. But that's another state. And so now you have Yahshua saying that the scriptures are about him. And so when we see that, then we can see that everything, we have to believe that everything that took place in the law are about Yahshua the Messiah, because it's a spiritual operation that's cutting away that egotistical, misdirected personality, and we don't even know it. But it's by learning these steps, this tabernacle of being able to have something to line up in order to convey the things that we're seeing. That's in the vision that's within our consciousness, in order that's going to restore what? The faith in Yahshua the Messiah, right? Now, if he says that it's about him, we got to find out what he's coming to do it for. Matthew 3:24, and then I want Luke 24:25, I think. So when we see that he set everything up by them, now he's come. He's telling them, hey, those scriptures that you had, which were written by the fathers that we had read in the scripture reading, that they wrote, and that how the Spirit, they said that they had Spirit in them by which they wrote and did things. The Holy Spirit moved those fathers, if you will, from Adam all the way down until Yahshua Messiah. They wrote by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. They're not knowing, but they were inspiring. And so now when they were expiring, Yahshua was coming in to do something about all of that has transpired. We're not looking at a boat no more. We're not trying to find a tree, no garden someplace. None of that is physical, according to what Moses wrote about, according to a vision, which Aaron brought up. Do we have that read?
Matthew 3:24 doesn't exist.
Oh, no, did I say Matthew?
Yes.
Third chapter?
Yeah, you said 3:24.
I want Messiah baptized of Yahshua.
13. Matthew 3:13.
Yeah.
Then cometh Yahshua from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be baptized of him.
Now look, John
made him saying,
hold on,
I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me? And Yahshua answered him.
Can you hear me, Eunice? That's fine. What we're looking at. Now look, Yahshua is coming to be baptized of John, right? That's the baptism we know is a water line, right? Or a burial line, correct? Where's the death principle in this event? He's coming to them. What's the death principle? You see, he's being baptized. They're in the world now. They physically, literally trying to baptize you in the water, unless you're not going to have any part with this guy coming back, right? But yet, where's the death at? In this principle.
from the beginning.
That's the burial. The death is that John, being the last prophet, was baptizing them because they were dead. They were dead to the righteousness which this law, if they could keep. Remember, this law was given to them in order for it would be unto their righteousness. And so they were coming to John the Baptist to be baptized of John, because John is baptizing them into the death of them thinking that they were going to be able to fulfill this covenant. So when you have when that's expressed, whereby John is bearing them unto that death state of those Jews, right? Because it was also all he was baptizing with the Jews into their death. That's because they thought they couldn't keep the law, so they said, "Hey, do you have any sin?" "Hey, yes." That's their death. They had to die. They're thinking they're going to be able to fulfill this law, and so therefore you got a death. Then they buried. And then they come up out of here resurrected. But it's Yahshua now that he said he fulfilled, as we just had read, that was that law or that act of baptism was finished or fulfilled, if you would. Right? And so that's a fulfillment of that old law according to being baptized of John. And only the Jews were subject to that, because that's what was instituted. And so now Yahshua is fulfilling or finishing this act. So it suffices us to do this, John, in order to fulfill. Now Aaron said, for 33 and a half years, walking around in Palestine and Judean hills, he's finishing the law, which was to them unknown, but to us, we can see according to the Jews and what they journey and how they journey in order to see the spirit of Yahshua fulfilling. Luke 24 and 23. I think we can go over a little bit.
Luke 24:23. And when they found not his body, they came, saying that they had also seen a vision of angels, which said that he was alive. Mm-hmm. And certain of them which were with us went to the sepulchre and found it even so as the women had said.
So this is after his death,
they saw not.
After his death, burial, and resurrection of Yahshua Messiah, or his death and burial, they're at this state, and Yahshua is resurrected. They've come back to this tomb, and it's empty, essentially. And now we're going to pick up a part. He's going to talk about Moses. Read.
Then he said unto them, O fools and slow of heart, to believe all that the prophets have spoken.
And slow of heart to believe all that the prophets, which was the law and the prophets, that have spoken. They weren't speaking of them own stories. They were speaking of the Holy Spirit, which he was fulfilling. Everything. He's done so many things. Saul says there's not books to contain all the things that he fulfilled, right? So all what the prophets have said, you ain't believe none of those? Read.
Ought not the Messiah to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? Mm-hmm. And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself.
So right now, this is why we endeavor to say is by knowing and understanding how Yahshua Messiah was and what he was doing, fulfilling what he had instituted according to the scriptures, one can see that what was manifested according to a spiritual understanding of why Yahshua was fulfilling the things he instituted, whereby we can have a confidence in our life. Because as we grow up, we end up, and everybody is in Egypt at one point or another. Mm-hmm. Right? They've come from out of that father's womb, down into that burial state, and they go through the birth situation with the 40 weeks, right? And then what? You're a child, don't know nothing, don't know who your mama and daddy is, don't know. That's darkness to them. And then you grow up And as you come out into this world, and for a period of time, we toil and wander around, not knowing which way is up, until we get a calling, as we had it read there in Romans. We get a calling by Yahshua's grace in order that you might see what? Who Yahshua is by hearing, by going over the things that he had for us to repeat. He told Moses to rehearse the things he was doing in Yahshua's ear about the battles and the things that he had to endure and go through. And so we rehearse. People oftentimes say, we're talking about Moses again. We're talking about the migratory pattern again, the elementary chart again. We're talking about the death, burial, and resurrection again. Hey, we're rehearsing because it's the same pattern in operation nonstop. And so we have the law and the prophets, which they didn't believe in, and Yahshua's letting them know after he's resurrected, right, that old fools and slow of heart not to believe. But then now, at an appointed time, he spent somewhat 40 days. It is the type here in the holy place, if you would. And then when he ascended into heaven, 10 days later, well, we have the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, right? At the appointed time, which was June the 6th here, fulfilling that June the 6th of this law that was set up here at the base of the mountain when they came up out of Egypt. And so when you see and can hear according to that Holy Spirit, which is the law, beginning to be written in your heart and mind, whereby you have the strength and the information to seek Yahweh and to know Yahweh. Give me Hebrews 10 and 8, and I'll be right done. No time, right, Sean?
Hebrews 10 and 8.
I think so, yeah.
Above, when he said, sacrifice and offering, and burnt offerings, even for sin, thou wouldest not.
Yeah, he didn't want any of that. Keep reading. Actually, just give me 8 and 10. I think I got dyslexia.
But 8
and
10.
Hold on. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith Yahweh. I will put my laws into their mind and write them in their hearts.
And that's that
and
law.
I will be to them their Elohim, and they shall be to me my people.
Keep reading.
And they shall not teach every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know ye Yahweh, for all shall know me from the least to the greatest.
And so that's why we come from different manifestations, but the principle, according to the doctrine, which is the doctrine of a reconciliation of the way we used to act, the way we might have carried ourselves by the gospel and by the belief and seeing and hearing and striving to work towards these things. We can be more in the likeness and image of Yahshua the Messiah. So if you got anything out of tonight's class or today's class, all praises to Yahweh our Elohim by way of Yahshua the Messiah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
This has been another lecture sponsored by Ontario of IDMR. any announcements? No. No. All right. We hold classes here on Sundays from 11 to 1, and on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 to 9:30. All donations will be accepted by myself if you have any, or you can wait till next class for Eunice. Please stand to be dismissed. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and forever. Let us all say, Hallelujah. Hallelujah.